So I came to London this weekend to attend the Association for Afferent Imprint Practitioners, and I had a chance to sit down with Simon King this weekend and have a little discussion about afferent input. So welcome, Simon, and thank you for taking the time to be here.
Thank you, Alan. Good to have you along.
Thanks. We had a really great day yesterday. Lots of really interesting things were discussed, but let's just kind of go back to basics and talk about sort of the basic ideas around afferent input and specifically about muscle testing. I know many people that are watching this right now, when they hear muscle testing, certainly within the chiropractic community, has got a lot of bad press. So let's just start off talking about that. Why the bad press? Why is there a lot of negativity? But on the flip side, why is it such a powerful tool in our toolbox in order to evaluate patients?
Well, I think the biggest problem with muscle testing is people not understanding how muscles truly work. And so there are a lot of misconceptions. I mean, the basic one is that your brain is controlling your muscles. But for 100 years since Sherrington published his research, we've known that there's a two-way communication between the brain and the muscle and the muscle and the brain. And actually, nearly all of your brain messaging starts as an afferent input, which is a sensory input, and most of that is coming from your muscles. That's where it's muscle spindles that are providing the activity that the nervous system uses to function. So your brain isn't producing anything, it's just processing. And when I'm talking about brain here, I'm really talking about brain and spinal cord. Right. And where afferent input focuses a lot of its attention is into the cord-based reflexes. Okay. And we spend a lot of time understanding cord-based reflexes, the very work that Sherrington uncovered, and we use that to make sure the power output from the muscles or the control over the muscles is as good as it can be. Because what we now know is that the stronger you are, the more power that your muscles are generating, the longer you live and the less injuries you get, the less illness you get. And yesterday I presented 41 different references that link muscle strength or muscle weakness to ill health. So the weaker you are, the more ill health and you have, and the earlier you die.
Right. So, I mean, it's a fairly simple concept. I mean, if there's a way that we can measure muscle strength and improve that muscle strength, then ultimately we're helping the patients get better. But why do you think very little people do this? Where has the, when we look at muscle strength, muscle testing, that just seems like a logical place to start to evaluate somebody to try and identify what's going on with them. But yet there's very few people that are actually doing it.
No, and if they are doing it, they're doing it in the wrong way. I mean, a tool is only as good as its ability to be used and the way that you use it. And so many people don't use muscle testing in a way that's physiologically accurate. So the thing about resisting injury to the body is you have to be able to resist an external force. You have to be able to engage a muscle against the force and then use the muscle. And so if you're not testing in a way that duplicates what people would suffer in their real life, then it's not a valid and useful test. And unfortunately, many people are using muscle testing in the wrong way for the wrong things, and it's just not a useful tool in that case.
Right. So let's talk about that. So what would be a wrong way to use muscle testing?
So sadly, a lot of people have no idea about how muscle testing, how muscles actually work. And they've turned muscle testing into a type of dowsing. They've turned the ability to push on a muscle into verbal questioning or testing for things that don't really exist. And sadly, if you use muscle testing wrong, it can become a very subjective test. It can Right. become a test where the practitioner is either testing themselves or their ideas or the patient's ideas, and none of that is physiologically accurate. Like, if people couldn't function physically independent of their thoughts, you would never have marathon runners and power lifters, because a power lifter knows they can lift, you know, they can change their thoughts but still lift the weight.
Right.
And so, people are trying to test thoughts or things that are not physiologically relevant, and then it gets a bad name. And people think they can test things because the muscles change, but it's just the poor way that they're testing.
Right. Okay, so that's a great explanation of, yeah, I mean, that makes a lot of sense. And then, you know, I mean, that explains a lot of the YouTube videos that we see out there. So then what's good muscle testing?
So the ability to resist an external force. So you're walking along and your ankle twists. What allowed that to happen? You know, there's some people who have twisted their ankle 60 or 70 times in their life, but other people have never done it. So what stops your muscle, what stops your ankle from twisting is the myotatic reflex, which immediately initiates a contraction once a stretch starts. And this is the very same reflex that we see in a knee-jerk reflex. And so if you take that and translate it into proper muscle testing, where you're testing the ability of the person to withstand an external force, then you get muscle testing that is reliable, and it's also relevant to the person as far as injury prevention. And if you also correct those reflexes, then you find old injuries heal much faster, almost instantly sometimes. You know, for instance, Alan, you've come through the applied kinesiology system and training. Now you're teaching applied kinesiology. But you've been always a good friend of mine, and you've seen my stuff. And how does what I do differ from what you've been doing within applied kinesiology?
Yeah, it's a good question, because, as you do a new video or introduce something and I go to watch it, the first thought in my head always is like, I'm not going to learn anything new. I mean, I've seen a lot of this stuff. I've seen a lot of, you know, great muscle testers. I pay attention to a lot of the different techniques are out there. But what I love about the afferent input are where you take basic concepts, so basic muscle tests, and you think through it, and you get to a place where, well, why would you do this muscle test when you can just test the whole chain and get kind of a feeling of what's going on with the whole arm or with the whole leg in a way that the patient naturally moves. And so a lot of the ideas that you teach really just go back to basic ideas that we're here just to improve a patient's function. So rather than isolate, why don't we just test the whole thing altogether? And it just, I always come back when I watch these videos to this idea that we're not reinventing the wheel. You're just taking ideas and sort of peeling them back into the basic movement patterns. And that's what I find so fascinating, because at the end of the day, it's really about how a patient functions. And if you can evaluate how they function in their daily life, identify the where they're not functioning, do something about that. I mean, they'll be with you for the rest of your life, and they'll refer.
And it's a really efficient system, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm ultimately lazy, and I don't want to do 10 tests when one will do.
Right.
And so the more I can refine things down to an efficient way of testing and getting the result that you need that makes the patient better, and the quicker you can do that, that's what I'm all for. So, yeah, you're right that you've got to do it in a quick and efficient manner, but also get the result that's relevant to the patient, which
right.
means making them better instantly if you can.
Yeah, and I mean, so far in my experience has been that, yeah, you don't need to take an hour or, this whole hour and a half consultation in order to get there. I mean, you can find these problems almost instantly if you know what you're doing and you have the right tools to do that.
And also you need to be able to, I mean, you want to be so good that you can just lie a patient down no matter what they've got and know that when they walk out the door they're going to be better than when they came in. Not because you believe it to be true, but because that's what their evidence tells you, that they're moving better, that they're in less pain, that they're more functional, that they feel better. Because once your nervous system's better, it affects everything.
So when I was first in practice, I knew as a chiropractor I would help patients, I would adjust them, and I knew that they would get better, but I really had no indication of when that would be or how long that would take. And the difference now is that when I go through that afferent input concept and start evaluating the body from this perspective, I know if I can make everything strong and robust, I know the next day or the day after that there's going to be an immediate response. The patient's going to feel different and come back feeling. And so far, I've not been disappointed. On the second visit, there's always a comment of, I'm feeling a lot better. Sometimes maybe the next day there was a little bit of a reaction, but ultimately 100% of the time they come back with a very positive effect, and it's you can determine that based on the response they get from the testing.
Well, I mean, that's the ultimate thing here, and it's 17 years now since I developed this concept that your nervous, I mean, it's fairly well known now, it wasn't then, that your nervous system is being run by input and not just output. So your nervous system is run by output, and in the 17 years, I always try to disprove my ideas. I'm always trying to challenge them and disprove them, right. And so far I haven't managed to do that.
Yeah, and that's an interesting thing too, because I'm always trying to do that too. So I mean, every time I come up with a new idea, I'm always like, this idea, this is going to just disentangle Simon's ideas, and I'm always trying to outthink or out better. And so far, just the basic process of using the right muscle test and doing it in the right way, I haven't been able to beat that. There's just nothing that comes better than just looking at the basic concepts of how the body moves, evaluating it, and then fixing it. So now we know what accurate muscle testing is. Why is that valuable in practice?
Well, in practice, you want to eliminate the interference to the way the nervous system is working. And so you need to reverse engineer a weakness so that you can find how to fix it. So our approach in efferent input is always look for the weakness. We're always going after where is the weakest link in this person's system. And it's often very remote from where the actual pain or the injury is. So you start with the injury and maybe there'll be some weakness around there, but there could also be patterns of weakness which will lead you to an origin of an interference that is quite remote from there. And it's this tracking back into finding the interference in the nervous system, which is what makes muscle testing so valuable as long as you're doing it right. And so what we teach in efferent input is how to test the muscle in a way that's relevant to the person's injury, and then how to reverse engineer that into the right treatment for that person and that day.
Okay. So there's two things there I think that are really important. Is one, just talk about an example of where that would play out in real life on the table with a patient. So you talked about, you know, this injury, which could be, you know, further up or further down from where you're looking. What would be an example of that you see in practice?
Well, you can, I mean, the example I just gave with the ankle, people rolling their ankle, you know, that could easily come from a spinal problem with the muscles that control the peroneus longus, which is the muscle that's going to prevent the ankle from rolling. And the peroneus longus, of course, is controlled by the S1 nerve root, so you're looking at the L5-S1 area in the spine. But the spine works as a unit as well, and that L5-S1 area may come from the weakness that controls the L5-S1 disc, could come from anywhere else in the body. And particularly in afferent input, we're looking for sources of persistent bad afferent input.
Right.
Now, you could get an idea of this just by thinking about the things that we do to remove bad interference. Like if you stood on a nail, you wouldn't try and massage the person, you wouldn't change their nutrition, you would take the nail out. You step on it, you have a pebble in your shoe, you take the pebble out, even if it's not really hurting you. And we know that afferent input can even work in fairly innocuous ways. If somebody tickles you on the foot, and we have this connection between our skin and our muscles, and it's really important that our vulnerable structures, our skin and our mucous membranes, are not interfered with by stuff that shouldn't be there, foreign bodies, for instance.
Right.
And so that's where we get into looking at jewelry with people. So if people are having their skin irritated by a piercing, which is essentially like a nail in your foot,
right.
You know, you'd take a nail out of your foot, but why would you leave one in your ear?
Right.
From a physiologic point of view, it makes no sense. And what we find when we test the muscles properly, we can actually find the effects of those piercings. And then when we remove those piercings, people function better. They get better muscle afferent input. They get better output to their muscles, and therefore they're not as vulnerable to injuries, and whatever injuries they do have heal much faster. So it's about finding the right treatment for that specific patient so that they get better from whatever they're suffering from at the time.
Right. And I think, you know, like in a future video, we're going to, you know, we'll show examples of that.
Sure.
But one of the other things that came out of something you said is when we learn muscle testing at school, I mean, most of it has come from Kendall and Kendall. And so we're looking at, you know, specific muscle tests to specific muscles like the pectoralis major clavicular or the rectus femoris or the peroneus longus. But you mentioned something about looking at patients, you know, in a sense, how they move, or can you talk about that? Because I think, you know, if we do muscle testing or if we evaluate the body per se with a patient that's suffering from something, we're always looking at specific things. So in that area or that specific joint or that specific muscle. But you talked about the, you know, just evaluating the body from this movement perspective. So talk about that and how that is important.
Yeah, muscle testing's had an interesting history. It started with Kendall and Kendall, and they really went into looking at individual muscles. And then when George Goodhart came along with applied kinesiology, he took the Kendall and Kendall muscle testing and again, he took it back to individual muscle tests, and he developed systems for treating individual muscle weakness. But our bodies don't work on individual muscles. Every time you get a muscle contraction, you've got its antagonist being inhibited. You've got all the synergists that are acting together. And when you're talking about movement like walking and running, you're talking about whole body muscle actions. And if you understand that the brain has got to function with all of these various inputs coming from all of your muscles, you understand there has to be a lot of regulation into the central nervous system that gives you an accurate and steady amount of input into your central nervous system. Mm. And so when we are evaluating muscles with afferent input, we're taking a whole body approach, and often we're taking a whole body movement approach. So yes, we do go down to individual muscles when it's appropriate, but we're also doing large movement approaches, which AK doesn't touch at all.
Right.
So we're testing, you know, all of the gait running muscles all at once to see whether there's any functional problem within the gait movement, within running or twisting or jumping or throwing or any way that we can to stress the body, to put it under stress, to make sure that we have that person in their optimal state. And of course, that's going to vary according to what people want to do. So if people are powerlifting or Olympic athletes, we're obviously going to stress them much more than your average person. Right. But the principle is the same. And the principle of a functional muscle. And it's not a muscle that's weak through inactivity. It's a muscle that isn't functioning because the control of the muscle isn't there.
Right. Interesting.
And we know that inhibition is natural. You know, you contract your biceps, your triceps is always inhibited. It's a natural state. Where it becomes a problem is if it's persistent.
Right.
And there's something else causing it. We know that inhibition is also silent. When your biceps is contracting, your triceps feels exactly the same. So there's no way for a patient to know that their muscle is inhibited.
Right.
Often the first indication they get is that they've got an injury.
Right. Talk about that too, because I think that's an interesting thing that we don't often think about as doctors, is this idea that patients walk into our office with an injury. And, you know, for instance, you're dealing with sporters, and you have a football player that comes in and says, "Doc, I rolled my ankle. My ankle hurts because of the game that I just played and made a bad move and my ankle rolled." And the assumption there with a lot of doctors and a lot of patients is that rolling that ankle caused that problem.
Yeah, and you got two problems there. One is, you don't have a time machine to go back and stop the person rolling their ankle. And the second thing is, was it the event that caused the problem? And that was one of the frustrating things in my early days of practice. You know, some people could break every bone in their body but make a full recovery. And other people would bend down, pick up a shopping bag and never get better. And it wasn't the amount of trauma that they had that determined whether or not they got better. Right. And then you go to treat somebody and you'd have two people with almost exactly the same injury, supposedly the same set of symptoms. But one would get better in two visits and the other one's not better in 25 visits. So there had to be another reason. And the reason is the functional state of their nervous system and how well their muscles are able to be recruited to protect the joints. And that's right. one of the major functions of muscles that people overlook. Muscles are there to protect your joints.
So I think one of the thoughts or questions that people are going to have watching this video is that typically in chiropractic or really within any medical field, people walk into our offices with a paradigm about something, but the doctors also have a paradigm. So, you know, we have, you know, the bone out of place kind of model that if we just put the bone back into place, everything will be fine. Or we've got the idea that if you can just identify the defective movement pattern and give a set of focused exercises on that defective pattern, that everything will respond. How does afferent input fall into that? Because, I mean, the first thought somebody's going to have is like, oh, this is just another technique system that is, giving their paradigm onto a set of parameters.
So one of the interesting things about afferent input is that every practitioner, every physical medicine practitioner is already practicing afferent input, because every time you touch or have any physical contact with a person, you are influencing their afferent input. Right. And so afferent input as a paradigm covers all of the physical therapies. It explains why they work, but more importantly, it explains the times when they don't work. Right. So it explains massage and posture and neurology, and in fact, it's using all of those approaches. So if you do an orthopedic test and you find a restriction in motion, afferent input would tell you that restriction of motion exists because the muscles that pull that joint through that range of motion are not firing effectively. You have a weakness of those muscles that pull that joint through the range of motion. So orthopedic testing is just a manifestation of muscle weakness, which we would find with afferent input. Right. Same with neurological testing. And you can take a panel beating approach, you can take a bone out of place approach, you can take all those approaches, but really they're covered within the afferent input paradigm. And my sales pitch, if you like, is that once you understand afferent input, once you can use it better, you can use any therapeutic approach you want, but at least you'll have mastery over that approach. Right. And with the afferent input paradigm, you'll understand it better, you'll be able to use it better, and your results will be so much better.
Great.
And essentially what we're after here is a full understanding of how to make a patient-specific diagnosis.
Right.
We don't want to diagnose according to conditions, because we found out that doesn't work so well.
Right.
In fact, it hardly works at all, because a condition can have more than one cause.
Right.
And until you've got the cause nailed down, you're not going to be able to cope with the condition. So we have a patient-specific approach, and it doesn't really matter what condition they're coming in with, we're going to make them as strong and robust as we can.
Right.
And it's this idea that the patient, once they're robust, once everything's working properly, is able to go out into life and conquer whatever challenges life throws at them. And that, to me, is the best we can do as practitioners.
I agree.
Yeah.